Major funding for NOVA is provided by the following. David H. Koch. And
Discovering New Knowledge. HHMI.
And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. And by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
We're 10 seconds away on take two.
Dave Ferrucci is a nervous parent. He spent the last 4 years building a revolutionary new computer, and it's about to face its biggest test in front of an audience of millions.
Hello, my name is Watson. I hope we will have a good game today, but first I have to test my voice.
When the cameras roll, the computer called Watson will make history as it competes on the popular quiz show, Jeopardy. Jeopardy!
It's frightening, right? I mean, it's a different experience. It's a very different experience for a scientist to sit here and, you know, have this happen live.
Six, five, seven, four.
Ferrucci has reason to fear. Watson is playing for a $1 million jackpot against the game's toughest competitors. Brad Rutter, Jeopardy's biggest money winner. And Ken Jennings, famous for winning 74 consecutive games.
There's some contestants' pride. I want to beat my human competition, but, you know, as a species, I would like mankind to beat the big bad computer.
Let's finish leaders of World War II.
All right.
This big bad computer is the culmination of 4 years' intensive work. IBM has put Watson through hundreds of practice games with a stand-in host and real contestants.
After Germany invaded the Netherlands, this queen, her family, and cabinet fled to London. Maria.
Who is Beatrix?
No. Watson?
Who is Wilhelmina?
That is correct.
It's a human standing there with their carbon and water versus the computer with all of its silicon and its main memory and its disk.
It seems like it should be easy for the computer to win with its enormous memory and processing power. But the human brain makes an intimidating opponent, especially on Jeopardy.
Jeopardy questions are tricky. They have puns in them, they have little jokes in them.
Just understanding the question is a pretty big deal.
This trusted friend was the first non-dairy powdered creamer. Watson?
What is milk?
No. Maria?
What is coffee, mate?
Thank you.
Humans communicate very fluently in, you know, natural language, and that's where computers struggle dramatically, right?
Now, Watson is on the verge of conquering that challenge.
Here we go. A garment worn by a child, perhaps aboard an operatic ship. Watson?
What is pinafore?
Yes, how did you get that?
If Watson wins on Jeopardy, it will be a major breakthrough in a quest that's gone on for decades. The audacious dream to build a machine as smart as a person. The quest for artificial intelligence, AI.
I am Electro. My brain is bigger than yours.
When we started doing AI, the goal was, why can't we build a person? We all know how to make people, that's easy. What if we could build one out of silicon?
Pioneers drew their inspiration from the world of science fiction.
As a child, Isaac Asimov turns up. So here I'm an adolescent, and the robots, intelligent machines, are part of my life.
At your service.
Let's see about getting them built.
In the early days, computers grew rapidly more powerful, quickly mastering complex equations.
The first programs we wrote at MIT solved problems that only very educated people could solve, like problems in calculus and then algebra.
The computer pioneers thought they were on a fast track to building human-like intelligence.
I confidently expect that within 10 or 15 years, we will find emerging from the laboratories something not too far from the robot of science fiction fame.
In the beginning, we thought, well, maybe 10 or 15 years and we'll have something that's really smart. In the beginning, people really were amazed at how much computers could do. When you see something is improving very fast, you simply assume it will continue improving that fast indefinitely.
In the 60s, confidence was so high, it inspired one of the most iconic film characters of all time.
Hello, Hal, do you read me? Do you read me, Hal?
Affirmative, Dave. I read you.
When I was a kid, I saw 2001 A Space Odyssey, and Hal was just the best thing ever.
Open the pod bay doors, please, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
You know, it was a murdering psychopath.
Hal? Hal?
But it was intelligent, could talk to people, could see people, could lip read, could do all this stuff. A machine that could do that. And I'd never even seen a real computer at that time.
I was mesmerized. I was instantly mesmerized by the character Hal. There's this one part in the movie where one of the actors in the movie is sketching quietly. And Hal asks him,
have you been doing some more work?
A few sketches.
May I see them?
He says, oh, I'm sketching. And he says, can you show me the sketch? And he holds it up.
Sure.
Can you hold it a bit closer?
That's when I got goosebumps, because that's such a human thing to say.
I think you've improved a great deal.
And I said, this is wonderful, Hal. What does it take? What does it take to build something like this?
Bishop takes knight's pawn.
More than 40 years after the creation of Hal, no one has answered that question. No real computer or robot has been able to interact with humans as seamlessly as Hollywood imagines.
Tell me, what is love?
The problem is our own human computer, the brain, a complex entity that's defied any attempts at replication.
We just had no idea how sophisticated the brain was.
The computer has always been king when it comes to calculation and processing huge amounts of data.
Pen is in the pen. What's the middle letter?
E.
But simple skills that humans master early in life, like understanding language or recognizing objects, continue to baffle researchers.
You know, people vastly misjudged how subtle we are when we're intelligent. People just hugely underestimated that.
But the dream of building a computer that could talk and match wits with humans never really died. And a few years ago, a new plan was hatched, sparked by an unlikely event.
This is Jeopardy!
In Wagner's operas, this eldest Valkyrie is stereotypically dressed in a horned helmet and breastplate. Ken.
Who's Brunhilde?
Correct.
In 2004, Ken Jennings' 74-game winning streak on Jeopardy set the country abuzz and caught the eye of an IBM executive while out to dinner.
All of a sudden, the entire restaurant cleared out to the bar that I'm sitting at to go see Ken Jennings.
This grand old Opry comedy star used to wear a straw hat with the $1.98 price tag still attached. Ken.
Who's Minnie Pearl?
Minnie Pearl. Howdy.
Funny hat's for you.
Charles Licko wondered if a computer could ever play as well as Ken Jennings. So he pitched the idea to some of IBM's top scientists.
For the ones that knew Jeopardy, they said, Charles, that's just too hard.
I think the prevailing view was, these questions were difficult to understand, difficult to even comprehend what was being asked.
Yeah, I was like, no way. I was like, no way.
But one researcher, Dave Ferrucci, was intrigued.
My view was, maybe this isn't as completely impossible as we think it is.
And now.
For over 40 years, Jeopardy has been pop culture's IQ test. Clues are given as answers, and contestants have to respond in the form of a question.
Mother's 1600.
It's a larger vessel that guards and supplies smaller ones. Christina.
Was a mothership?
Mothership, yes.
And the show's central conceit is a little syntactic reversal whereby they give you an answer and you supply a question. You don't say George Washington, you say, who is George Washington?
To win, contestants need to be human encyclopedias.
Because it's essentially everything under the sun.
First in this round.
You know the categories at the same second Alex tells the folks at home the category.
One, you have to have a broad knowledge because we have 13 categories on each show.
Kate, start.
PH for 400.
For the record, Thomas Edison invented the first practical one of these in 1877.
Contestants also have to be fast.
Ariel.
What is the phonograph?
Good.
They typically have 3 seconds or less to come up with an answer.
The mortar and pestle is a symbol of this profession. Ariel.
What is a pharmacist?
Pharmacist is right.
To compete on Jeopardy, IBM's computer must have an enormous knowledge base because it will not be connected to the internet. But the far bigger challenge for the machine will be understanding clues, which can be extremely convoluted or obscure.
You'll find this flower before pickle bottom in a line of handbags and bedding. And that would be petunia. Back to you, Ariel.
There'll be a lot of puns. There'll be double meanings. You know, and these are things the computers historically are terrible at.
Human language is a minefield for computers. Consider this sentence.
As it go, I shot an elephant wearing my pajamas. Was I wearing the pajamas? Was the elephant wearing the pajamas? Right. So there's different interpretations, different ways to parse the sentence. The word shot, you know, what's really going on there? There's already ambiguity in there. It could actually be shooting, sort of a hunting shooting. If I'm a photographer and I'm immersed in that context, I may interpret that as shooting with a camera. Which one did I mean? So you have to look at the context.
But a computer has no context. It's just an electronic brain in a box. In 2006, Ferrucci tackles this challenge, along with the best and brightest programmers from IBM and the country's top AI labs.
The way we solve this is actually...
To start, they run a test. One of IBM's most sophisticated computer programs, hundreds of Jeopardy questions, like this one. In 1698, this comet discoverer took a ship called the Paramore Pink on the first purely scientific sea voyage. The correct answer is, who is Edmund Halley? The computer says, who is Peter Sellers? The computer ran a search through a million documents, looking for key words from the clue. It homed in on a description of one of the Pink Panther films, in which one character was a paramour, or mistress. The star of the movie? Peter Sellers. It's probably the last answer a human would come up with, but it's typical for computers. The team has a long way to go. Just how far becomes clear when they compare the computer to the best human players. They create a graph called the cloud. Each dot represents a Jeopardy champion's performance. Jennings is at the top.
What you see is a cloud that's around, they answer around 50%, the winners do, and they get around 90% correct.
And where is the computer in this cloud?
If we ask it to answer all the questions, it'd be getting 10% of the questions right. You can't go on Jeopardy like that. I mean, the best humans, they're 90%, 92%. We weren't even close.
To win at Jeopardy, the team will need a whole new way to tackle human language, one that takes advantage of the computer's basic strengths. At its electronic core, a computer speaks a very simple language, binary code, on or off. But with that simple code, it can follow instructions and solve complex problems, once reserved for intellectual giants.
It used to be the case that intelligence was chess, right? If you can play chess, that's intelligence.
Computers have mastered the game.
Chess is easy for computers because the rules are very well defined and very clear.
The rules of chess are relatively simple, a board of 64 squares. Each piece, pawn, knight, queen, can move a certain way. And there's a single goal, take out your opponent's king. For humans, it is the ultimate game of strategy.
The way computers play chess is not at all the way people play chess. We humans look at the board and have conceptual ideas like control the center, attack on the right. Very different from the way computers play chess.
A chess-playing computer looks at virtually every possible move it could make and every response, every way the game could play out.
Computers play chess through searching a tree of moves down to a very deep level, looking ahead on every possible path, but they do it by brute force. They go 20, 30, 40 moves ahead and seeing all the bad things that can happen. A person can't look that many moves ahead broadly.
This is the power behind the most famous chess game in the history of AI. When in 1997, another IBM computer named Deep Blue beat the reigning world champion, Garry Kasparov.
The chess world champion walked away from the match, never looking back at the computer that just beat him.
The victory makes Deep Blue look pretty smart. But is it?
deep blue. It's only acting as if it's intelligent. It's not really intelligent in the way that we humans are.
It's good at one thing, it's playing chess. It can't do anything else. There's no other understanding of the world. It's just about chess moves.
This lack of understanding has hampered every computer program that's tackled human language. A perfect example is a program from the 1960s called ELIZA.
ELIZA was one of the first programs that had anything resembling human conversation. It was a dialogue. You type things in and type things back.
How do you do? Please tell me your problem.
I'm feeling sad. Then it types back. Did you come to me because you're feeling sad?
ELIZA was programmed to respond like a psychiatrist, but it had no real insight. Instead, it followed simple rules and rearranged key phrases.
So if I say, I'm dead, it responds, do you enjoy being dead? It doesn't have any understanding that dead is a different kind of condition. Really is just doing this sort of fill-in-the-blanks kind of pattern matching.
Anyone who tried to solve the language problem hit the same brick wall, the computer's profound ignorance of what we take for granted every day.
There's just so much more that we know that we don't know we know. I mean, just we know all kinds of stuff, like you press the up button in the elevator, that means it's going to go up, or milk is white. Or water's wet. I mean, it's just stuff that we know that we don't even realize we know. That's one of the things that makes it hard.
All the common sense knowledge a human brain collects naturally seems much too complex to program into a computer. But that hasn't stopped one scientist from trying.
So we have actually manually entered about 6 million rules. That's about 3% of what it's going to need to know in terms of actually spanning what you and I would call human common sense.
For the last 25 years, Doug Lenat has been leading a team trying to create human-like intelligence by teaching a computer common sense, rule by rule. The program is called Psych, and at headquarters, the walls are covered with logic diagrams.
In a way, the magic of this, the power of this, is if you just tell it each rule one by one by one, and you give it general logical reasoning capabilities, that's all you need to do.
So far, Psych has 6 million rules and can answer a lot of common sense questions, like this one.
Can.
Psych says no, and it explains why.
Here, it's essentially saying the reason why cans can't can is that cans are inanimate objects, and it knows that can dancing requires at least partially having a brain and using it. It's just enough for Psych to get the right answer for the right reason.
25 years ago, many experts considered rules and logic the best hope for building artificial intelligence. But it's become clear these alone are not enough.
It's not just a matter of piling in more and more stuff. There are basic principles that we didn't understand. Putting in more and more stuff doesn't get you basic principles.
At IBM, as Dave Ferrucci and his team tackle the Jeopardy challenge, they know that facts and rules are just the beginning.
We couldn't write rules for every combination of word and phrases and context.
They need a new system, more fluid and flexible, to navigate the twists and turns of many different kinds of Jeopardy questions. They named their system Watson, after IBM founder Thomas Watson. The electronic Watson consists of 2,800 processors. That's like 6,000 high-end home computers. Altogether, it's the size of 10 refrigerators. The team starts filling his memory banks with about 10 million documents, most downloaded from the internet. Because when Watson plays Jeopardy, he must stand alone, just like his human competitors.
All kinds of content, okay, encyclopedias, dictionaries, thesauri, books, plays, you name it.
The entire World Book Encyclopedia, Wikipedia, the Internet Movie Database, much of the New York Times Archive, and the Bible are just some of Watson's resources. And to build on Watson's foundation of data and rules, the team turns to a powerful tool in the computing world. It's called machine learning.
Machine learning is just like human learning from examples.
Before, people would just write rules by hand. Nowadays, it's all based on examples.
To understand how machine learning works, consider for a moment the letter A. What if you had to describe it to a computer? It's a real problem faced by the U.S. Postal Service, whose computers must decipher all kinds of addresses, printed and handwritten.
We all know what an A looks like. I know when I see it, but there's just way too many different types of A's. There are fonts where the A is just a triangle pointing up, right? That's an A. Pretty quickly you realize there is no simple set of rules that you can write down currently for a program to determine whether a letter is an A or not.
Humans might not be able to come up with the rules that reliably identify all kinds of A's, but it turns out a computer can do it for itself, if you give it enough examples.
The way you do it is you just get an A, send it to the program, and say, that's an A. Here's another A, different one, that's an A. Here's another A, it's a different one, that's an A. Then you would give it another example, then you would give it another example, and you would do that a million times.
The computer hunts for patterns among all those examples, and it finds them. So the next time it meets a letter A, even one it hasn't seen before, it will recognize it. This is machine learning, and it's a crucial element of Watson's programming. The team trains Watson. But here, instead of letters, the examples are tens of thousands of old Jeopardy questions, along with a cheat sheet of all the correct answers. Using machine learning, Watson will hunt for patterns between the type of question, the correct answer, and the kinds of evidence that support that answer.
Now, we do this over thousands of questions, so we come up with some way to weigh the evidence on average so that we come up with the right answer.
Now, when he's faced with a brand new question, Watson uses what he learned from these patterns and declares his confidence in each possible answer.
In the end, we get a list that says, here's the top answer, and we're 75% sure it's right.
Watson has now become a complex architecture of rules, raw data, and machine learning that enables him to use statistics to choose the right answer. To test out this system, the team scours the halls for IBM employees who can play Jeopardy. And everyone squeezes into a conference room.
In 1978, New Jersey Monthly reporter Stephen Levy famously found this man's brain. Watson.
What is Einstein's?
Albert Einstein's, yes. The Fifth Amendment says that private property